Swayam Prabha. Digital India. Educated India.
Madam, start.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to this live session on great experiments in psychology. So I hope you enjoyed this course. We had a lot of ambition while doing this course. When we planned it, we thought it's going to be, it'll be an easy thing to cover because psychology, there are a lot of interesting things that we could actually cover in psychology, and especially, when we are talking about experimentation and other the research studies that have happened in psychology. But when I took about the development of this course, I realized that it's too much to be covered in 20 lectures. So I had to pick and choose, and I tried, I'm not sure whether I did justice to it, but I tried to cover as many possible topics as possible, that could be covered in this brief period in time. And, the objective in mind was to give you a flavor of different domains of psychology. So we started primarily with the history of psychology in the first module. So to give you an idea how psychology evolved as a science from philosophy, from almost all our subjects, all our academic subjects have evolved from philosophy. But how psychology evolved as a science, how it developed from the concept of the soul to consciousness and to behavior, and to being objectively studied, as in different research designs showed us over the course. Now, from the history of psychology, we also get to understand, I try to give you an idea about how the geopolitical movement influence the way we think about research in different subjects, in different sciences. So psychology was not only influenced by philosophy as its root, but it went on to be influenced by mathematics, by physiology, and by different other perspectives in science. Also, it got influenced by the two world wars that we had, and the way people think was influenced, the geopolitical conditions influenced the theorists as well as their experimentation. Initially, I thought I will cover only the experiments in psychology, but then, on the process of designing this course, I realized that it would be injustice if I did not take up a couple of studies that were famous in psychology that helped to build psychology as it is today. And so in the first module, we started with the history of psychology. We spoke about development of experimental psychology, the influence of different other disciplines. We here I highlighted on psychophysics. I spoke about Weber and Fechner. And of course, the evolution theories, I did not leave out Darwin and Galton and their contributions to psychology, though they were actually not psychologists. And I spoke about the father of modern psychology, that's Wundt, and his disciple Titchener. And of course, also he, hinted at Kulpe, though I didn't cover Kulpe much. So the second week, we tried and focused on cognitive and social psychology. And there were just too many wonderful experiments and studies that were done in this area of psychology. So it was really tough to decide which are the topics that I should be taking. Primarily because cognitive psychology is a separate branch of psychology, social another one, and there are just too many wonderful studies. But then I thought that we should not miss out Ebbinghaus. If we are talking about cognitive psychology and if we are talking about memory systems, we cannot deny the contribution of Ebbinghaus. And of course, from memory, we saw the impact of the social conditions on how memory systems can change, how psychology has affected other disciplines like law. And there we talked about Lofter and Palmer's experiment on eyewitness testimony, and how eyewitness testimony not being foolproof was discussed, was shown by Loftus and Palmer. Then McGinney's experiment on perceptual defense, perhaps I could have left it out, but perceptual defense is another very important area that has an impact on advertising. So especially in the field of subliminal perception. So I did not wish to ignore this aspect of psychology, because then we would, a large chunk of advertising depends on psychology. And this is one of the starts. So if you go through the lecture, you will see there's a wonderful study on subliminal perception. You can also Google about it, how Coca-Cola used subliminal perception to influence their sales. So then I spoke about Festinger's cognitive dissonance theory, and how this is one of the most confusing theories. And on the comment section, I've also received comments about cognitive dissonance being really confusing. And it would be a good idea to go through Festinger's original paper. It's a wonderful discourse. And then after cognitive dissonance, I thought it would be important to talk about Milgram. Now, Milgram, if you see, the first three theories are more of three studies that we talked about are mostly from the perspective of cognitive psychology. Cognitive dissonance is cognitive social psychology, is from the domain of cognitive social psychology. And Milgram's experiment on obedience was influenced by the geopolitical conditions. So this was conducted post-World War. And the researchers' personal experience had an influence on the way he thought about people. And Milgram being a Jew, he closely followed how the Germans were treating the Jews, and he came up with this Germans are different hypothesis. Milgram's experiment on obedience, his objective was to show that Germans are different, and he planned to conduct the experiment in Germany also. He initially started doing it in Yale. And he wanted to show that people follow despite having the option not to choose whether to follow or not. So this is one of the most controversial experiments in psychology so far. And the simple reason is that it was declared, the major controversies were on ethical issues. And Milgram had to stop the experiment. So I thought that it would be a good idea to discuss this experiment. Of course, there are several other related experiments that I skipped, in similar contexts. Moving to module three, that's week three, as we spoke about clinical and health psychology, and we spoke about Watson's experiment with little Albert, where he demonstrated how phobia can be developed. So J.B. Watson, a strict and ardent behaviorist, believed that you could actually build anybody as the way you would want to. It would just depend on, it was a stimulus response context, and you could actually create any kind of individuals. So here, he introduced fear to a little Albert, a small boy. And this was, again, one of the most criticized experiments, because Watson did nothing to remove phobia from the child. So this was, so I thought that this would be an important experiment to discuss in the clinical and health psychology domain. OCD was another one, and Rappaport's article in OCD showed that this was a diagnosis. The mindset of OCD had changed from this paper. This paper got a lot of views and popularity because this was the first time it was brought to the notice of commoners that OCD is an illness and that can be treated and it needs to be diagnosed. This, I thought it would be contextual considering India, where OCD is a part of a cultural training that many of us are accustomed to. So, cleanliness would be a virtue. And, cleanliness, whether it's in the term of being systematic and extremely rigid or ritualistic, might not be considered as an illness even today. Even today, in most of the rural settings, OCD is more often than not undiagnosed, unless it really causes problems in daily functioning. So, discussing two clinical psychology papers, I thought it would be important to focus on the anti-psychiatry movement. And so we discussed about the study by Rosenhan, where he showed that even expert clinicians cannot diagnose a mentally ill patient. And this study also got a lot of views and a lot of criticisms. There were some flaws with the study, but again, it pointed out this was the start of the anti-psychiatry movement, where people started talking about schizophrenics being different from the norm and showing or reflecting creativity. But of course, if we go by the diagnostic criteria of ICD, that's the International Classification of Diseases, or the DSM, which is the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual for Mental Disorders by American Psychiatry Association, APA, and the first one by WHO. These set out a criteria for the diagnosis of specific diseases. But at the end of the day, the Rosenhan study is important because it brought in new approaches against the psychiatry movement. So, and finally, I ended by this module with the story of Dibbs. Dibbs was not a hardcore academic or research experiment, but the story of Dibbs by Virginia Axeline shows the importance of responsiveness in therapy and how play therapy, even to this date, if you read the story of Dibbs, that's a wonderful book, and it's a real story that has been developed into a book. So a case that was developed into a book, and you even today the play therapy principles that were scripted by Virginia Axeline are followed, and it is important to understand from this research the unconditional regard that is required by every child to give him that respect. I think to me and to most of the world, one of the most interesting researches in psychology was in clinical psychology was of multiple personality disorder. And we cannot miss out talking about psychology researches and studies and experiments if we do not discuss the story of Eve, or the three faces of Eve that was given by Cleckley and Thigpen. Cleckley and Thigpen were two clinical psychologists who reported a case of multiple personality disorder, which is better known as dissociative identity disorder today. And this was such a popular study that it actually became, it was made into a movie which won the Oscars, which won the Academy Awards, and also the Golden Globe Awards. And this, in fact, there were, so the Chris Sizemore, who was the, whose story was depicted into the movie, came up, Cleckley and Thigpen mentioned about three faces of Eve. So that was Eva, Eve White, Eve Black, and Jane. But Chris Sizemore came up later that she had actually undergone 9 personality changes. So this was one of the classical studies of clinical psychology. After clinical psychology, I think we would do injustice if we didn't get into more of interpersonal psychology and the role of culture. And there I thought I should mention about prejudice and how it can be created. So prejudice is how prejudice is learned. And I spoke about a class divided by Jane Elliott. There's a wonderful YouTube video by Jane Elliott. And she conducted these studies with school children. She was a school teacher and primary school teacher. And she also conducted it later on with prison staff. And it shows how prejudice is learned. Of course, after that, how personal perceptions affect the way we think about people. So, you know, discussing that, I spoke about the false consensus effect. That was another paper. Finally, we went into Lee Ross's experiment on Lee Ross's study of androgyny. And he used a scale to show that both men and males and females have different kinds of, so both characteristics of female traits as well as a male trait. But there are some socially desirable behaviors that we express before people. And finally, not to miss out another very important experiment in psychology, if you are from management, you perhaps have studied about the marshmallow test by Walter Mischel. And this shows how self-restraint and self-control can actually have an impact on long-term behavior. So, you know, there were lots of things that I missed out. In fact, if I just, you know, I did not talk about the cognitive revolution. So, in fact, the role of how psychology was impacted the development of cognitive science, primarily the AI, artificial intelligence, the role of cognitive psychology and the cognitive revolution in the development of AI. Now, I did not talk about language, you know, and I think, I feel bad that I haven't covered one of the most important experiments that led us to understand the different areas of the brain that were responsible for personality. So this case of HM. So you can look it up and, you know, on Google. I did not cover Freud. I did not cover several aspects of developmental psychology. I missed out on Zimbardo. So this would be Zimbardo's prison experiments. He conducted the prison experiments in Stanford, is a continuation of Milgram's experiments on obedience. So, and there are of course some other experiments in learning, like Bandura's Bobadol experiment, the effect of the bystander effect, and how pro-social behavior can be built and, you know, how individuals behave in a social situation. And of course, I left out decision-making and problem-solving experiments that have been conducted in the sphere of cognitive psychology. I hope to come up with an advanced course on experiments and studies in psychology where probably I'll be able to do more justice to the newer research and all these questions. I can see that there are a whole lot of comments and queries. regarding the there are I can see regarding examinations. So I can see that there are some questions on exam and how to prepare for the exam. So regarding exam preparation, this is mostly going to be related to you know, the assignments that you have done so far. It's going to be an MCQ again, and it will be similar to the assignment. So there's no special rule, and the questions are not going to be much different from what you have answered so far. Well, there are, I can see one question on phobia. Just give me a minute. Okay, regarding, I can see another question on books, the reference texts. There are two major books that I followed for the development of this course. One is Key Studies in Psychology by Richard Gross, and the other is Classic Cases in Psychology by Jeff Rolls. So that's a Routledge publication. So you can check these books, and you could go through the original studies or videos on it of the case of the experiments that I have discussed so far. Let me just see if there were any other questions. Well, Dr. Abhishek asked me whether I plan to do any course on psychotherapy, cognitive behavior therapy. Well, I would definitely love to, but at this point in time, I haven't planned any course per se, but perhaps in the long run, I will. Regarding questions again, it's going to be MCQs. They are not essay types. Okay, Porush and Shazia, if I have got it right, that's going to be MCQs, right?
Yes, ma'am, it's going to be MCQs.
Okay, so that's it. So I would like to introduce my two TAs who have diligently worked for the development and for conducting this course. So we have Porush. He has just cleared his...
Hi, everyone.
BTech, a dual degree from IIT Kharagpur. And there's Shazia. She is a research scholar with me. So she is, again, a clinical psychologist.
Hi.
A big thank you to both of them for really taking it upon themselves to help me with this course. So coming back to the questions. Okay, has ethical standardization of psychological experiments put a brake on experimentation pathbreaking discoveries? Not really, because just to take this question from Swarna, desensitization in phobia is important. Okay, so because whenever we are talking of inducing fear, this was one of the criticisms of Watson's study, that he induced fear, but he did not do the desensitization. So, and by itself, systematic desensitization is one of the behavioral techniques that is followed. Of course, this was shown later, much after Watson's work, but it is important if we take up any experiment with human subjects, it is important that the ethical issues are addressed. And in fact, for most of the journals, they will ask us whether we have an ethical approval to conduct any experiments on human subjects, just like we have one for bioethics. Similarly, there are human ethics committees. So, experimentation hasn't been stopped because of ethical issues. There were a lot of experiments that were conducted during the World War days, especially by the Nazi camp. But I'm not really sure whether experiments in psychology at that point in time have made a larger impact in the field of psychology. There's somebody, Smitha, I believe, has asked me something on, just give me a minute. Transaction analysis. Yes, definitely Eric Byrne's concept of transactional analysis is very important, but I did not go into the different schools of psychology, and if I got an opportunity to discuss transaction analysis, definitely the different roles would be a very, very important section, and it would take up at least two lectures. But I did not want to delve, as I mentioned, you know, into too many topics about personality and therapeutics. So I actually left out transactional analysis for that, for the advanced course. Okay, somebody asked me to suggest a research topic for MA psychology. So are you talking about a dissertation perhaps? So, you know, I mean, that depends on your interest, whether you are interested in interpersonal psychology or social psychology or cognitive psychology. I mean, you can always, there are a lot of research these days that's being done on, you know, behavioral changes due to the COVID situation or on the effect of, you know, online education. In the memory systems. So these are some small topics that I can suggest at this point in time, but there are lots many, and then it depends on what kind of work you are, domain you are interested in, domain of psychology you are interested in. Social engineering, somebody has asked how social engineering is different from psychology. It is not different from psychology, but it has developed from the broad umbrella of psychology. There are a lot of people, when you're talking about social engineering, a lot of people work on the development, on the use of social capital, and the impact of reinforcement. But I would suggest that that's more on the application aspect of psychology. Now, psychology has developed over the years, and it has traveled a long way. And there are different branches of psychology. So there are you would get people in clinics who work from the therapeutic aspect of psychology. There are hardcore experimental psychologists who work with biomarkers. There are others from experimental social psychology who work on real-time field experiments with human beings. Of course, organization psychology is another branch. But these are the applied branches have developed. As I said, advertising, military psychology, forensic psychology, all this are, developments from psychology. Somebody has said, should we have a degree in psychology to conduct clinical psychological experiments? One needs to have a basic training in psychology. So it depends on what kind of experiments you are trying to do. You could always try out a memory test on one of your family members, but that wouldn't be, or you could try out one of these online available scales to assess your intelligence and personality. But that wouldn't count as a study or an experiment unless the methodology is very, very robust. And for that, a fundamental training in psychology is required. So And for publication in a journal, so if you're looking towards academic publications, it would require a certain amount of rigorous methodology. It would also require you to be a part of a system, an academic system. Okay, there's somebody mentioning that he is a digital marketer. On which module of psychology is best to take MA psychology? You know, you could, I would suggest that you could go in for specialization on cognitive psychology. But again, you know, it's not only about specialization. You need to have a fundamental degree in psychology. So the basics of psychology, believe me, when I started studying psychology, I thought that it would be, you know, I would understand people very well once I saw them, and I would, you know, be able to tell about their personalities and behaviors and all kinds of things. But psychology is way different from that. So the fundamentals of psychology are not at all, they tell you very rigorously that you actually cannot interpret behavior like that. So, you know, the fundamental studies of psychology is very different as compared. So one needs to have an idea about the fundamentals before going into the applied sections. Okay, Porush, can you just type the names of the books, or shall I type it here?
Ma'am, I've mentioned that we'll share a doc with them with the list of the books on the discussion forum, so that all the other people who are not in the session can also access it.
I think that would be great. Thanks. We can also give them the link of some of the papers, perhaps. That would be a good idea. Okay. I guess that's about all. Are there any other questions that you would want to ask? So what type of questions will be asked? I think we've already answered that that query earlier. So these are primarily going to be MCQs. And do we have a model test paper? We don't. You know, it's similar to the assignments. Can we get this session on YouTube later? I think we can, right?
Yes, ma'am, it will be available.
Great. So I guess that's about it for this course. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I enjoyed teaching it. And if there are any other questions, anything else that you would like to know, just feel free to mail to me. And we would definitely try and address as many questions as possible. How many MCQs? I guess there'll be 50.
Yes, ma'am, there are 50 MCQs.
50 MCQs. I hope I could instill some interest in the field of psychology. So if there are no more questions, then we could wind up, shall we? Or is there anything else that we need to cover, Porush and Chazia?
Ma'am, there was just like two questions that we received earlier. One on, I think you mostly covered them in your introduction about the marshmallow test and the phobia thing.
Yeah. Yes, I can see you put it down for me that... At what age would people generally develop phobia? Right. So it's mostly before the age of 25. So we have generally young people suffering from an anxiety disorder. So there is no gender discrimination, but it's mostly the young people. Is there any common platform where we can contact you? I think, Porus, you could share my mail ID with them.
Yep, I'll do that.
Yep. Thank you so much. I think, Porush, we can wind up, shall we?
Yes, ma'am. If there are any, and if there are no more questions, I think we can wind up.
Okay. Oh, there's somebody trying to write down a question, I believe.
Someone's asking, will the course be rerun because they missed the registration for the exam this time?
We'll have to follow that up with the technical team. I'm not really sure whether it's going to be rerun. Do you have any idea whether it's going to be rerun?
No, ma'am. I think we'll get to know that next year. I mean, yeah.
Okay.
And there's one more question. At what age group will play therapy be helpful?
Play therapy is helpful for the for children, especially the primary group children. One of the reasons being that many a time language acts as a hindrance in expressing oneself. So for children, they can express themselves much better through play. In fact, another way that is used, which is a development from this kind of therapeutic techniques, is the use of drawing, the use of color, the use of drawing for expressing self. And that could be used for, a larger section of people, for a larger age group as well. Drama has been another way of expressing self. And as you can well understand, that works for children as well as adults. So, these have a cathartic effect. So it's not only an expression where language acts as a barrier, but it also helps in a way of relieving the anxieties through the therapeutic program. And many a times, drama is used for such an expression. Could you suggest some research topics in social and developmental psychology? If you are looking towards research in social psychology, one very important area of study is public opinion, and how public opinion is affected, how it changes the way we perceive things, how it affects decision making, and there is another for developmental psychology. You could also check on to, purchasing behavior. So what kinds of things generally that we, why do we purchase something, a particular brand, or, why do we go to a particular store or a particular mall for buying stuff? So how is that affected by, the people in our environment? For developmental psychology, there are a lot of topics. One would be a very, very important topic for the current age is the effect of COVID on children. The effect of memory systems, as I mentioned earlier, the effect of online education on attention, on memory systems again. So the effect of internet gaming on behavior, on personality, on an attentional level. The next question, as I can see, is opinion about neuropsychology in India. Neuropsychology is an independent area of study, but in our country, we don't have too many labs for neuropsychology. They are generally associated with a psychiatry unit, or they are associated with a research unit. So if you're looking towards studying neuropsychology in India, I would say, one way would be to getting attached to a clinical psychology unit, like say perhaps NIMHANS. and or CIP, that's the Central Institute of Psychiatry. We have some of these mental health colleges, institutes that specialize in mental health. Otherwise, if you're looking at neuropsychology abroad, it is a very good option, but especially neuropsychology in dementia. In India, one of the best places for neurology and neuroscience other than NIMHANS is Sri Chitra, which is in Kerala. Their neurology unit, if anybody is interested, you can get in touch with them and perhaps look into practicing neuropsychology. But training in neuropsychology, unfortunately, it comes with a clinical psychology program. We don't have independent neuropsychology trainings in India. If somebody else wants to study psychology, and is not from a psychology domain, there are huge number of books and material available. So that's not a hindrance if you want to know more about it. But if you wish to become a psychologist, if you want to have a degree in psychology, then it would be better to join a program. And generally, there's a difference between studying psychology and studying counseling or doing a counseling training. So what I try to emphasize in this course is about core psychology experimentation. So if anybody is interested in research, then you would need to go through a fundamental academic training in psychology. And there are a large number of colleges in India that offer programs in psychology. At this point of time, that most of the programs are online, as the pandemic has brought about certain changes. So you could explore your opportunities, look into a psychology program, and further your academics from there if you're interested. So I guess we've had a very, very lively and interactive discussion. The problem is, I just get to see your messages, but I really wish this was more physical. Can you say, okay, Aisha has this question again. Can you say about what neuropsychologists do in their field? Okay. Neuropsychologists are, their work is to do the assessments to see which areas of the brain are functioning or not functioning well. Okay, and this is because this is more related to illnesses and diagnosis. So you go through, there are a lot of neuropsychology books available, but if you go through one, the study of HM, you will see the role of neuropsychology. So by the help of assessment tools, so by the help of some questionnaires, some small tests that one conducts, the neuropsychologist conducts, he or she can say which part of the brain is not functioning properly or what kind of illness is the person having. Now I'm talking of brain disorders. So something like for dementia, for people with, old age problems, which is, moving towards clinical diagnosis like Alzheimer's, one can, the neuropsychologist, by conducting a couple of tests, can actually say that, well, this part of the brain is not functioning well for this person. So that would that needs to be corroborated by other imaging techniques like MRI or CT scan. And after that, the psychiatrist, or in this case, the neurologist, gives the medicines. So it also, the neuropsychologist also identifies the progress of the disease. So if there's somebody who's suffering from dementia for a long time, what is the condition right now after medication? Has it improved? Has it lost, you know, has it gone worse? So things like that. Psychology is very interesting subject, but a scoring subject as well if you choose. As far as I remember, you know, a couple of years earlier, people would generally choose psychology as an optional subject for competitive exams. And I know of several such people who selected psychology and cleared the IAS civil service exams. It requires a tedious amount of study, but it's not very tough. So if anybody wishes to take it up for the competitive exam, I think it would be a good choice. What is the scope of health psychology? Okay, you know, in India, primarily health psychology is again overlapped by the domain of clinical psychology. We do not have a public health degree that is beyond the scope of medical practitioners. So, but if you look at the other countries, health psychology is very important. So we don't have a specialized degree after master's in health psychology in India. So as far as I'm aware, you don't have an MPhil degree in health psychology in India, but you would have an MPhil in health and clinical psychology. That's the one that is, or health and medical psychology that is provided by NIMHANS and some other clinical psychology units or institutes. But if you're looking at Hopkins, one of the major schools of medicine in the US, they have a public health program, and their health psychology is a very, very important area. So it depends on where you are studying, but I have a feeling that health psychology will gradually develop in India also, considering the pandemic situation and the huge impact it has on health. But it would be advisable that you have some fundamentals of physiology or you know, biology before you get into health psychology. So coming from a discipline of humanities would probably not be a good idea, because there would be too many competition through the medical people. So that's my take on it. I think we'll have to wind up now. It's almost an hour. If we don't have any further questions, maybe we'll wind up. Think of some more queries on the process. Us, we will, as Porush said, my mail ID. So we'll probably take in some more questions. Cognitive science and what is the scope of cognitive science in India? Well, cognitive science, I would love to talk about a part of which I teach. So with the development of cognitive science is actually psychology, cognitive psychology, AI, all that as a part of cognitive science. There are center for AIs that are opening up in our country, and cognitive science by itself is also an area that will require people from the background of cognitive psychology. As of now, there are a lot of companies who work on AI devices, especially where human interaction is important. They take in people from cognitive psychology. It would be a good idea if there is somebody from the field of cognitive science. Cognitive science, as I said, master programs in cognitive science are gradually opening up in different parts of the country. If you just do a Google search, you will get to know of some of these programs. when students move on from first year to final year of graduation, Mr. Bhupinder, this is not within the scope of this discussion, perhaps, but I'll take this question. Okay, so this is, well, students have a lot of behavior change and it depends on their progress over time. Mostly when students come in a residential college program, when students come in the first year, there is, and I because I belong to an engineering institute, I see students here, the undergraduate students for 5 years, five long years, 4+ years primarily. So they're, yes, initially moving on from their roots to a different place of study, to a different culture, it has its effects. But as maturity would have it, they are psychologically more mature by the end of final year. And so that's the fourth or fifth year during their graduation. And if we are talking of, so their perspectives also change, as in their objectives change, their goals change, their take on things change. So as in, you know, initially in the first years, they would probably be looking at doing away with their financial dues. But in the final year, they are looking towards a job and they're looking towards more, they're more confident about themselves. They know what they are looking forward to. They have a better self-esteem as compared to when they started. There are, of course, different other areas when discussing the progression of age and academics. I'll not get into that. What is the scope of certification course if you're from a different, what's the scope of this certification course? Well, to be very honest with you, I'm not really sure. Okay, I wanted to give you a flavor of psychology. If you're from the psychology discipline, it would be a rebrush if you haven't gone, if you have gone through it. If you haven't, then it would be an added knowledge. But if you're looking towards this course, as a, you know, as a certification, you know, to add on to any qualification, I'm not really sure about that. But if you're interested in furthering your research or your study in psychology, probably then it would benefit you. Yes, I did not focus on education. I did not focus on many other things. It would be a good idea if I did. Unfortunately, you know, I tried to restrict it to 20 lectures. So it wasn't possible to focus on educational psychology. But there are a lot of wonderful courses and programs on educational psychology that are available. To start with educational psychology, I should have focused on Bloom's taxonomy, which probably you are aware of. Well, you know, there are many things I left out. PsychD is not offered here. Okay, so there is no program on PsychD that's available in our country as of now, if I'm not mistaken. So, but you could always pursue it out of the country. So, well, I guess we'll take a final call now. We'll wind it up. And looking forward to other queries and discussions over the mail. So feel free to get in touch. And thank you so much. Thank you, Porush and Shazia. I guess we'll wind up now.
Yep.
Thank you.